Hello and welcome to this week's edition of Twa Teams One Street. I'm Tom Duthie, and podding alongside me today are George Cran.
Hello.
Alan Temple.
Hello.
And Graeme Finnan.
Hello, everyone.
No messing about today. George, is Zach Robinson in the huff yet? Two goals and everyone's only speaking about Pineda.
We should
clarify, Dundee won 3-1 against Dumbarton to put themselves back in the running for League Cup qualification, and although Zach got two, the Mexicans scored his first Dundee goal.
I'm sure Zach isn't too fussed because it meant he didn't have to do press after the game, and he's not a fan of doing the press, although he does speak quite well. It was all about the Mexicans. Obviously, we saw Antonio Portales finally got his international clearance. He got a booking, first of many, I think. He got his clearance through, must have been fairly close to the game, because we were up speaking to Stuart Taylor for the preview. What day is it? Tuesday afternoon.
And yeah, they played the Wednesday.
It hadn't come through at that time, so it's good to see him on the pitch. Looked very comfortable, I thought. His first game in a long time. He's only trained a few games. But Pineda, he came off the bench on Saturday and looked a bit rusty, but looked a couple of nice touches. You could see he's stepped on again in just a few days. He looked a lot sharper last night against the Barton. He took his goal really well in off the post. Good start for both of them. And I'd say we were expecting Portales to like a tackle, judging by his videos we'd seen, and we saw
he didn't let you down.
No, one of his first things to do in the first half was somebody got in behind him, and out came the big sweeping slide tackle, took the ball, passed it to his mate. Brilliant. Tried again in the second half and wiped out the boy on the edge of the box and got a booking. So
getting the best of both worlds then, aren't you?
Yeah, that's maybe just a bit of rustiness. Hasn't played in a long time, but it's good to finally see them on the park and see what a bit the fuss is about. They look like they really add something to the team, I think.
Yeah, Bear, it's good to get them both playing. Good to get your strikers scoring too.
Yeah, great start. You want to go off to a good start. All strikers want to get goals, and he did. He took his goal really well. And he showed other good touches as well. Without wanting to put a damper on things, I've got to say, it is early days. What I will say, he is lightweight, and that concerns me slightly, but his movement is good. And if he's scoring goals, you know, they can't go, oh, if it's a goal every game, damn, we're going to be laughing in that Premier League, hopefully. So it was a good start.
But he's gone from caution and playing things down to, if he gets a goal every game, he'll be gone by Christmas.
He might be gone before the transfer window closes, damn, we Dundee operate. But he brought a bit of excitement, to the terrace, to the stands, and Portales as well showed what he was made of. But there were other good things as well last night beyond the Mexicans. Dundee, the one thing again that lets them down big time is it was 3-1 full time, and but honestly, if it had been 6 or 7-1, it wouldn't have been an injustice to Dundee, and they're passing up an awful lot of chances. Mm. When they're on top in games, and that concerns me slightly. Hopefully the Mexican can address this, but we need others. There were good opportunities for Zach Robinson, there was good opportunities for Josh Mulligan, Lyle Cameron when he came on. Everybody seemed to have chances, and you're not going to get opportunities. You're not going to be playing, no disrespect to Dumbarton, who I thought were set up very well last night and played quite well for 60 minutes, as you would expect. You know, that they've got a decent manager there. But in the Premier League, it's going to be slightly different. The chances aren't going to be coming so thick and fast as they did last night, so that they'll have to take them. Another thing, with Portales coming in, I wondered how he was going to set up, and he set up with the three centre-backs.
It interested me. I looked at the team lines to see who dropped out.
Yeah, I was.
And well, the answer was no.
He set up with the three centre-backs, and it concerns me slightly because I don't think that Lee Ashcroft is a natural to be playing way over there on the right-hand side, and he got himself caught out. Not caught out, but I don't like seeing Lee Ashcroft in the right-back position, Tom. And if you're playing three at the back, more often than not, one of your centre-halves has to go out there. So it'll depend if Tony Docherty is going to stick with that. What I did like from that setup is it allowed Josh Mulligan to play, I think, which is what his strongest position, which is coming in off the right. You know, he's a powerful, powerful player. We saw a lot of strong run from him, some great link-up play.
Beck as well on the other side.
Yeah, Beck was an excellent. I've got George, as you're right, I thought Beck's been outstanding. Mm. They missed him on Saturday at Airdrie.
Yeah.
But he exudes class, I've got to say, which is the shouldn't surprise you coming from Liverpool. But there was a lot of good things from last night's performance. They still look a wee bit lightweight to me. I still think that they need an experienced midfielder in there. Lyle Cameron didn't start, which I thought he wasn't at his best on Saturday against Airdrie. But there will be games in the Premier League where Lyle Cameron, just because of the sheer intensity of the games and the way Dundee are maybe on the back foot and the physicality of games, Lyle Cameron may struggle to get a foothold. That's what we're going to need, somebody who can do a similar type job to Lyle Cameron, in essence, take the ball and hold it in there. And I don't think there is anybody at the club of that nature. And I also feel we still need a wee bit of weight up top. So apart from that, all good. They've put themselves back in the picture. And it should be another good game on Sunday against Inverness.
So Alan Bear's got Dundee winning the league and he's glum about it. And he's but one, I mean, sticking with the point he made about the three at the back thing, is that maybe a sign that Tony Docherty accepts Dundee are going to have to do quite a bit of defending in their first season back in the Premier League? Point being, the more you have to defend with three at the back, the less exposed you can be, because you're in your own half, your wing backs are more like full backs. Tends to be when you're bombing forward all the time that you're right or left centre half can be exposed down the flanks.
Yeah, I think sometimes we can fall into the trap of seeing a 3-5-2 or 5, as it may be at the back, as a defensive formation. I'm kind of the opinion there's no really such a thing as a defensive formation. It's how you're deployed within. Yeah. I've seen lots of Antonio Conte played 3 at the back when he won the league with Chelsea, and they were fantastic to watch. You know, so there are variations of that, but certainly it can give you stability when defending. What I think is more important, and it was interesting hearing you guys talk about it, is that is what's absolutely vital is if your wing backs are naturals in that position, because that's so important. They need to have the engine, they need to have the defensive ability, and most of all, they need to have attacking instincts. And it seems like Mulligan and Beck have both had that, you know, without wanting to take it to the other side of the street. Obviously, I watched United play a lot of three at the back football last season. It was the preferred formation for most of the season. And I think Scott McMahon, and whether it's Kieran Freeman or Liam Smith, would probably both say didn't excel as wing-backs, and that was a big problem. That's why they were so stodgy and uninspired going forward. So there's no reason why Dundee need to be like that, and it's exciting that what it sounds like maybe is happening, and I don't see enough of them to make the comment, but it could be that they feel stronger as in the wing-back position than they do in the winger position.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you feel like you're best wide players are Beck and Mulligan, and you want them to have clear air in front of them, then clear the way, get wingers out the way and change that shape. And that also allows you to play potentially an orthodox partnership up front without being left without numbers in the middle. So I think, I know there's a lot of naysayers with 3-5-2 or 5-3-2 as it may be, because it's seen as defensive, but I don't think there's any reason why it needs to be. And as Bear's saying, If Dundee could have won 7-1, then clearly it did create quite a few chances.
It's interesting, though, that was the first time we've seen any hint of a three at the back all pre-season and all the games. No point did Tony Docherty try it. So,
I mean, for what I've just said there, might it be a nod to the fact that Ashcroft, as is usually the case, hasn't done anything wrong. So Tony Docherty felt he shouldn't leave him out. He's done a three, but going on... if they're not suited to a three, they might go back to a four, and one of the centre-halves will have to be on the bench.
He's also brought in another centre-back this week, Aaron Donnelly. I was thinking he'd probably look more as a left-back, because he can play the left wing-back as well. But if they're playing three at the back, then he probably steps into the left-hand side of that.
Yeah. If Portales is slightly diminutive as well, then you would say that would be more suited to a three than necessarily a two as well.
So
I think if Donnelly can play on that left hand side, I think that Docherty has looked at and I look at Jack Wilkie, and Jack Wilkie's still, he's got potential, don't get me wrong, but he's still a wee bit away from being a a Premiership player, standard player. He's got, I think there might be a loan move for Jack would suit Jack.
Yeah, again, I think so.
And beef up a bit. And maybe this guy, Donnelly's come in, is a bit further ahead of him in terms of physical development and can slot into that left-back role if, you know, Beg's going to be a big player for Dundee. Yeah. You can see that this season.
Yeah. Everything I've heard of Donnelly is he's a hardy defender, very aggressive.
I think that's the sort of cover he's maybe, that side of the team he's looking for. But yeah, three at the back may work. I'm still not convinced that Lee Ashcroft likes it. I mean, if you're playing the team, Tam, you can't complain.
No.
You take the jersey, but I still think he looks uncomfortable.
He likes a fullback
close
to him. I know that. Even in a four, he doesn't like the fullback going too far away. So.
I can empathise with that. And I mean, in this plethora of tactical dilemmas that you threw up in the opening minutes here, we should point out, Bear mentioned the missed chances. Cost them dear on Saturday, and it could conceivably cost them a place in the knockout stages of the League Cup, the 1-0 defeat at Airdrie.
Yeah, I think goal different. If you're going for that second place, there's only three of the second place teams that are going to get through, and I think goal difference may well come into it. There's a few teams already on seven. You're going to have 9 points, I think, and there may even be teams on 10. So you need goals. So they're going to have to score some on Sunday. So the good thing about the weekend is they play it after everybody else, so they will know exactly what they need to do.
But if you were picking a team that you had to score a few goals against, it would not be Inverness, Caledonian Thistle.
No, especially after they shipped three during the week to Airdrie. And I've got to say, I was impressed with Airdrie on Saturday.
Credit to them.
You forget they are a Championship side now. They play a bit of football. They've got one or two sole players. Rhys McCabe, their manager, is a bloody good player, I've got to say, in the middle of the park. And they looked well set up, and they're going to cause problems in that Championship this season. But you're right, looking at Dundee, playing Inverness, isn't it? Dundee's record against Inverness is, I would say, a bit iffy, Tom. You know, that over the last few years have probably levelled out a wee bit. Inverness used to have the upper hand, certainly up north, but it seems to have...
Home's a lot different.
Yeah, so I'll be interesting to see. Billy Dawes certainly won't want to be going into the championship games on the back of two defeats, so they'll be up for a game. So one thing is, it's set up for a really good clash, which is what you want. You know, it should be a really good game of football.
Yeah, there's something that stake for Dundee at least, but it's a shame. It's because everything was on a high, but they did shoot themselves in the foot against Airdrie.
I've got it. Yeah, I mean, I disagreed with Tony Docherty slightly in the game against Airdrie. They didn't create very much. The front six, there were reasons for that. Beck didn't play, Robinson didn't play, so that's two big players taken into the team straight away. The front six players didn't really create an awful lot. Leo Carman didn't get his usual time on the ball, and that's credit to Airdrie for doing that. I think what Tony Docherty was alluding to was the fact that Dundee had a golden opportunity to get himself in front with 20 minutes to go, and I'm sure if Leo Carman had scored the spot kick, we would have went on and won the game. And Leo Carman,
I don't know, given last season, that you can call a penalty to Dundee a golden opportunity.
it's a bit like that. And I don't want to see Leo, I love you as a player, but I don't want to see you taking a penalty again. That's three I've seen him miss in the last 6 months. Yeah. You know, so he shouldn't really be... to be fair...
They do seem to get a lot of penalties when Zach Robinson's not on the pitch, and he's the one that has no bother with him.
Yeah, but the game as a whole, Airdrie, I think, deserved... I draw out the game. Dundee missed a few chances, not nearly as many as they did last night. And then what happens in football? What can happen? Happened. You know, it was a ridiculously soft decision. I've got to say, Colin Steele was the referee.
Colin Stevens, sorry. Favourite referee. Yeah.
Deary me. I mean, I felt for Jack Bulkey because the guy was going over towards the touchline with the ball, and you could see from here he actually threw himself at the ground. I mean, there may have been slight contact, but.
Maybe the referee had dinner booked and didn't want
possibly. Possibly. But
I don't like criticising referees, but Colin Stephen is a bad referee.
Yeah,
but when you do, you don't skirt around it.
I think what Tony Docherty said after the game was right. He'd almost blown for a penalty before the guy hit the ground in the box. I mean, he was sprinting to the penalty spot as if saying, yes.
I know. I don't like criticising him either, but he's not. I was quite glad to see Willie Collum refereeing last night's game.
Fair play to.
Oh, I think that's even worse than Alan's criticism.
Fair play to Airdrie. they won the game. Honestly, I think they're going to be a formidable championship outfit. I would not write them off. You know,
they were really well set up. You could tell their movement in the middle really caused them to
deal. Had a storming finish. I mean, everybody assumed Falkirk. I certainly assumed Falkirk were coming up to the championship via the playoffs, and Airdrie destroyed them and then beat Hamilton.
Well, I watched the playoff final, the second leg of it at Hamilton, and Airdrie were superb. Yeah. You know, they want to play a bit of football. That can become quickly undone, I think, because as much as you want to play like Manchester City, if you don't have the players that Manchester City have got, and you get pressed, you're going to lose possession. And Dundee did that a couple of times on Saturday, and she's really capitalised on it. But I think what would be cruel for Dundee is if they get the win on Sunday and the 9 points isn't enough and they go on the back of that penalty decision, which is that's what can happen in the League Cup. But we'll see.
In the end, it's up to you to take care of business.
Yeah,
Dundee to go to a newly promoted team in the championship and not score a goal.
Mm-hmm.
They're opening themselves up to what happened, aren't they?
Absolutely. And you know, that should be a lesson for them going forward. Strike when you're on top.
Yeah.
And take your chances.
And that goes for the games they won as well. Mm-hmm. Bonnie Rigg, they had so many chances and didn't take them. Again, as we were talking last night, they missed a load of chances, and it could be the goal difference it does for them.
That said, it was important. There's been a real feel-good factor all summer about Dundee. It was important that they bounced right back from the Airdrie defeat.
Yeah, there was a bit of criticism when you were leaving the stadium, as there always is from certain fans, but I don't think the fans were too disappointed. They understand it's the early days, and as I said, I've mentioned the players that were missing, you know, so you knew there was more to come from Dundee. And last night they showed that, I think. I mean, they were excellent. After they got their goal, got in front, and they lost a sloppy goal, I've got to say, from a set play, which they're going to have to sort out. That's the first one I think I've seen them lose over the course of the summer. Mm-hmm. But then, to be fair to them, they responded instantly, went right up the park, terrific move, right through Pineda, fantastic finish, and off the post. And then from the start of the second half, you saw they were a mile on top. And they went 3-1 up, and Dumbarton had a player sent off with about 15, 20 minutes to go, and Dundee really turned the screw in terms of passing and getting him behind, but just did not capitalise on umpteen chances.
Going back to saying it's important to bounce back, it's a funny thing in general. A lot of it has to do with how you finish last season. United lose a game and fans understandably are worried. Dundee lose a game, it's not so bad. Looking elsewhere in the Viaplay Cup, Arbroath seem to be the calmest set of fans in the world. They can have a disastrous League Cup group stage and they just go, well, it takes a while, we'll sort it out, which goes back to that thing very often, if you finish a season well, it's money in the bank for the start of next season, isn't it?
I also think it's worth noting that I think more and more fans are becoming aware of the pitfalls of this competition at this time of year. You know, if this was a few years ago when people were just getting used to this new format, there might have been a bit more pedal clutching and things like that, but we've seen so many shocks now over the years. There's so every single season at least two or three top flight teams lose.
Calm down a wee bit for a season or two, but it's back with a bang this season, isn't it?
I think more and more fans are realising that it's folly to judge your team based on losing a match, albeit surprisingly losing a match in the middle of July. It's just silly. This is the time of year where footballers are still being conditioned, they're still working on shape, they're still signing players. It's not good to be losing matches at this stage. It's not good to be knocked out of one of three competitions, but at the same time, it's madness to judge the rest of the season or what might be to come based on, and that's for good or bad.
Yeah.
But I don't think there's many people dancing on the ceiling about having a great Viaplay Cup group stage either, I think.
Aye.
There's,
For full-time clubs, and in particular Premiership clubs, it's a lose-lose group stage, isn't it?
It's no excuse. You should still be beating teams that are fundamentally worse for you because they're probably also in a state of flux as well, but it just adds a little, you know, a 10% of uncertainty, and that can sometimes be what swings a shock. So I think there is a sense of perspective among most fan bases, even as you say, even among Dundee United fans when they don't have any momentum from last season. So it's good to hear that obviously Dundee fans are not getting too carried away with that defeat.
I've got to say, well, the games are, for me, the games are invaluable because it's competitive games.
Yeah, absolutely.
It gets teams ready. I mean, Dundee, for all we'd like to go into this Viplay Cup and go as far as you can, because it is an opportunity to get to Hampden Park, somewhere we've not been getting close to 20-odd years now, you know.
Mm-hmm. Shouldn't have got promoted. Anyone in the championship's getting a trip.
I think it's 20 years.
It's getting 2003, wasn't it? We went in 2005 for the semi-final.
Oh,
2006 or something like that. So that was a good day. Yeah, but it's invaluable, the competitive games, because let's be in no doubt, the important thing is when the Hill ball comes out against Motherwell a week on Saturday in the Premier League, and then we'll see. But they should be at least match fit and ready to go. You know, you're not going to get caught lackadaisical, I wouldn't have thought.
And their strikers are already in the goals.
That's good.
All three of them.
And I suppose, barring a disaster, if you done a massive rebuild over the summer, new manager, new players, which only four were in contract or something like that. Mm. George at the end of last season from the first team squad. That are beginning to look like a team.
Yeah. He has moved, he moved quickly. He had to move quickly because, as you say, I think it was only three or four in contract. So he's got the ones signed up that he wanted signed up from last season. He's made some notable additions. I still think Joe Shaughnessy has been outstanding. He absolutely strolling through games for me. I hope he continues.
You were getting some stick for that Alan Hansen comparison last week.
I think it's
that crossed my mind. What people should remember is that it doesn't mean you're Alan Hansen or Dave Neary. You see, and I'm not being defensive here because I don't care, because we always get stick. But we're not saying that he's Alan Hansen or Dave Neary, but the mannerisms, the way they play,
and it's not a bad thing to have. I mean,
no.
I'd like to say Pineda looks a bit like Harry Kane, but it's early days for Alan.
I love to see Tam on the other foot here, because he knows how many times he's gone away from a press conference when a player's dropped that slight comparison. I see myself as stylistically the same as player X, and you go away and that's your headline.
Yeah,
and
you're like,
you've done that a million times.
And you're like, it's always better when someone else says.
Yeah,
you're always like, well, you said it, son.
Boots
I know what's going to happen. Somebody's first mistake, I thought you were Alan Hansen.
Shoes on the other foot
now. Just about Joe Shaughnessy, we've not seen Joe Shaughnessy has a huge throw-in.
I forgot about that. Yeah,
we've not seen it yet. I'm just wondering if it's just going to appear when there's 5 minutes to go and they're 1-0 down in a game, and they've got a throw-in on right at the top end.
Well,
of
that's interesting. Obviously, he's the captain. They played him in the centre of the three, but if he plays on the side of that, then he will take the throw-in.
To be fair, it does look as though he's going to score a goal sooner or later, because
he was unlucky.
He had a couple of decent headers last night, well saved by the Dumbarton goalkeeper. He does look like he's one of these centre halves also that can go up down, can actually header a ball towards a goal. No many centre halves that go up can header the ball, but put it on the target is very difficult. But
Jim Holton, Gordon McQueen.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
Sure, he gets more stick this week.
And I'll say Paul Heggart.
Oh, no!
He'll get more stick for that.
We'll need an extra mail sack.
But I wouldn't be surprised to see Joe getting on the score sheet. But the long throw, we're waiting for that one.
No, I forgot about that.
George, how close do you think the manager is? I mean, we've talked about, you know, the change at the back, and obviously we've had to wait for the Mexicans, and he's still signing players. How close do you think he is to being settled in his own mind about his team for the league opener, which is not far away?
I still think he wants more in. I think that's pretty clear. Spoke to him a wee while ago just about, brought in quite a lot of young players, and he said that wasn't particularly the strategy. So they were looking at more
experienced
guys.
There have been murmurings about that among the fans, that they would like one or two.
You can see that because they have got quite a few loans, obviously good players from big clubs, and they've got talent, but you
good
need
players from their own academy.
Yeah. They haven't got a huge amount of experience at Premiership level. There's a few still there from the last time, but the guys they brought in, only Shaughnessy really has any. Tiffany had a bit at Livingston, but other than that, the rest of them are all new to it. So I think I agree with Bear in terms of a midfielder. I think they maybe need somebody who's got Premiership experience in there, because that Airdrie game, the middle three, the oldest one was Malachi Boateng at 21. So it's a very young midfield, and you could tell up against Rhys McCabe in his midfield, they moved him about quite a bit and caused some problems in there. I very much don't think he's done in the transfer market. I really do want to see them
add to the hierarchy. They've backed their manager big time, haven't they?
They have. I mean, I just point to the pre-season trip away. I've said this before, but there was no signs of that happening at all until Tony Docherty came in, and they haven't done that for years, which tells you how much they're backing him and happy to do whatever he feels is necessary, and that'll mean bringing players in as well. I have also heard murmurings that they're still looking for a goalkeeper, which is interesting.
Why would he be looking for a goal? That seems very strange. It seems odd.
He said he wanted three, didn't he? So he's maybe wanting Harry out on loan.
Maybe.
So interesting to keep it. Interesting last thing as well.
Adam Legsons came into the goal after.
Yeah.
McCracken had played the first two games of the competition. So I wonder if Legsons will start on Sunday. And does that mean that he's in the box seat for the...
I know, it's still up in the air, isn't it?
Yeah.
Because he didn't really have that much
He didn't. He may have a bit more on Sunday, to be fair. Yeah.
And he is one of the most experienced players in that squad. And he is loud and organises really well. You can see that when you're watching on the pitch. Even when Dundee are attacking, he's shouting at boys... cover from corners and stuff like that. He's really good at that. So that's something that does add to it because it is a very young team. Exciting team, exciting players, but I do think they need a bit more experience in there. And that's where I think they'll be looking to add.
And before we move across the road, a couple of interesting departures. Paul McGowan, Cove Rangers.
Yeah, that was an interesting...
Dunfermline had wanted him, I think. That's maybe a sign of budgetary issues.
He'd been training with Dunfermline and played all the pre-season games as a trialist, but obviously couldn't play in the cup. And Paul Hartley came calling again, signed him for Dundee, signed him for Cove. He's such an experienced player. I think he'd be absolutely fine in League One and add a lot to Cove Rangers. And the hair looks great, I have to say.
You had it done again, or is it just...
No, it's just coming in good.
Is that Tom you're talking about? No, Paul McGowan.
I'm not going to Turkey for hair. I could... Size of my head, it cost a fortune to get that. And the other one, that Dundee legend, Jack Henry, teaming up with Stephen Gerrard in Saudi now. It's been confirmed as I was driving in.
Okay. It was confirmed. Talk of £80,000 per week.
He's a laddie who seems to move every year and always comes out smelling of roses because he went to Dundee.
A lovely footballer.
Yes.
Really a good footballer.
He's a guy who always does a great job for Scotland and impresses, but there's obviously something about him that managers go, when they get an offer, they go, I will take that. Dundee had to take it because it was the best
always,
part of it.
He was always one of these guys who's willing to take a risk, which I think is a good thing as well, because he trusts himself, he trusts his footballing ability to get himself out of problems, but he will get himself into bother by taking that risk. But the way the game is played nowadays at the top level, what's not to like about Jack Henry? You know, he's very, very quick. He's got the height and the strength to play at centre back. I really like him as a great move, and that's the money that he's getting.
And then when you speak to him, even back when he was at Dundee, he's one of the most confident people I've ever spoken to in his own ability, which you can see
he
on the pitch.
Believe in himself.
Yes, very much. And that's what's got him where he is. I think that's what got him to the Champions League with Club Rouge and getting the big bucks.